nothing to do with praise team or any of the praise team, so just listen up and don't hear it like I'm talking to you guys, okay? This actually started with Ruby. Many times I've gone there to her and watch her, not as much as she used to. She would start singing hymns. Of course, going to Bailey Manor over and over again, they don't even need the books. And I guess it was 2 weeks ago I was there at Bailey Manor, and I had already been thinking about this just watching Ruby. Could I do that? I love praise teams, praise music. Don't hear me say anything wrong. I love praise music. But being honest with you, without the promptings, I don't think I could do that, especially if I had Alzheimer's or dementia. And I recognize that those at Bailey Manor and Ruby, I mean, they never missed, right? Ruby was always in church, always had the hymns. She heard them over and over and over and over again. Now, there's not a long list that she can do, is there? There's like 3 or 4. She's got some favorites that she can pretty much do. The same thing at Bailey Manor. There's one man that, and there's several ladies, but one man in particular, I mean, he's got a few. I don't know what's going to happen to me, but I do know that they're still witnessing. And they're witnessing through song. And so the last few weeks, I've been listening and singing with us, trying to pick out one that I could repeat. And I can't. I'm not asking for a change. Don't hear me saying that. In fact, that's not what I'm saying, because a lot of our people, new people especially, they enjoy the way our worship is. But I want to still be witnessing when my mind is gone. And I want some of our children and some of your grandchildren that grow up in here, if the Lord tarries, I want them to still be witnessing when their mind is gone. So with that said, I thank you for singing a hymn this morning. And I would encourage all of our praise teams, every now and then, remind, because for some, they know. For others, you're going to have to teach them what is an old song. The other thing I want to share with you is, you know, the last month, and I leave for Montana Wednesday, and one of the things that the Baptist Convention in Montana has asked me to do is to share with them how to create or how to change the prayer culture in their church. That's something that I did for years with churches, and almost all the way through the month of September, started out in Knoxville. That's what they asked me to do. That's what I did. I've done it probably about 4 times through the month of September and leading up to now. And I did it differently than when I was with the convention. I say the same things that I said was I was convention, but I say it with a lot of confidence, more confidence now than I did with when I was with the convention, because normally when I was doing it if I was doing it for a pastor in his church, then it was because he had heard me do it somewhere else and wanted me to come and do it there. But if I was doing it in a room of pastors, inevitably a group of pastors would come to me and say, well, that may be good teaching and it may be biblical, but it won't work in a church Sunday after Sunday. And Now I look at those same ones and I say, you have no idea. One of the things I tell them is that, first of all, you've got to enter every worship with expectations that are high. That you come in expecting to meet God, and you feel kind of depressed and down if you don't have an encounter with God. But you got to come in with those expectations high. Second thing I tell them as a pastor, you've got to lead and not let them lead. You got to make it certain that they know what you mean about prayer and how they need to respond. And so about this moment, I will go through and I'll talk about our altar. I'll talk about that this, by just dividing it out, is believing that someone's going to respond and giving them an opportunity, and even giving responsibility, giving a expectation to those who can't kneel or even stand, but you have the chairs. I talk to them about what is written on our altar and the pins, and I talk about the cross, and I talk about the freedom that I have here. I talk about what I enjoy every time I get ready to preach, the men coming up and laying on my hands. You know what usually happens? That happened this week, because I shared, not this week, last week, I shared that, and one of the chairman of deacons came up to me, and he said to me, well, we pray for our pastor every morning. I said, where? Oh, downstairs in the Sunday school class. I said, why? How many of your people know that you are praying for your pastor? How many of them actually see you praying for your pastor? And why is it only the deacons? They had no response. No. The invitation is for the ushers and any of the men of the church. So you come on up, Bob. That's good. And I would love to have you lay your hand on me right here. There you go. Anytime. The point is, don't ever take for granted the freedom we have here. And I know there are churches that have more freedom, but I enjoy incredible freedom and incredible prayer support that many pastors don't even believe can be. The third thing I tell them is, throw away your bulletin. You stop telling the people when it's time for them to respond. Now, I'm not talking about our bulletin's not like that, is it? Our bulletin's announcements. But in most Baptist churches, the bulletin is the whole order. And most times they'll have the morning and the evening order, the whole thing laid out. And it even tells you when it's okay to respond. And I tell them, you can't do that. If you're going to have freedom, you can't tell the people that it's wrong to respond here, and they got to wait until the end. Which usually brings me to the other thing, which those of you that were with me at West End or Pulaski heard me say. I don't say it here much. Very seldom do I say it here. But when I'm somewhere else, I almost always begin, don't sin in this place. And I ask them, how could we sin? To know to do good and not do it is what? It is sin. And I said, to know that it is better to obey God rather than man, and then choose for a man to tell you when it's okay to respond, would be sin. And so don't sin in this place. Don't let me catch you sinning in front of people. Don't you think that God is still going to be waiting for you at the end because you told him to wait? And so I give that lecture every place but here. I don't have to do that here. You've heard it enough, and you can fill in the blanks, and you know that keep making God wait is sin. And so we move quickly to God. I want to say thank you is what I'm telling you this. I do recognize that I am blessed. You're extremely submissive and have been submissive to me and to my leadership. I can't think of a single hymn, but I can't think of a single time either. when you may have questioned some things, but you've always followed. And I appreciate that very much. All right, let's go to this passage. John chapter 14, verse 17. By the way, in Montana, I'm talking about creating a prayer culture. One of the conferences, not the whole thing. All right. I believe in the Holy Spirit. I believe in the Holy Spirit, Mark 6. He is a he and not an it. John 14, 17. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. Everything in there is he's a he and not an it. I don't think I ever got that until I wish I had gotten it sooner. I was in systematic theology class. I'd already been an associate pastor, was already pastoring, and had already been through 4 years of majoring in religion, and I'm at seminary in a systematic theology class, and the professor says, and it's on the Holy Spirit, and he says, first thing he says, the Holy Spirit is not an it, and if I ever catch you talking to him as an it in my presence, you can expect a strong rebuke from me. Well, when you've always been talking to the Holy Spirit as it, then what will happen in a class like that? You're constantly being rebuked, not just me, but the other ones, because it's just the easy language. We pray to him as it. We talk about him as it. And yet, what I just said is not new to you. You've read the scripture. The Holy Spirit is a he. It's him. He lives in us. Just like God the Father is Father and not Mother. Jesus is the Son and not sister, daughter. The Holy Spirit is he. He lives in us. He may give us power, but he is not power. He's bigger than an it. He's bigger than what he gives. That's the point. He may be spirit, but the spirit is he. That's big. In fact, that's probably the most important thing that you need to hear tonight before you go out of here. In fact, that's the whole message is about built around that, is recognizing that he is he. It may not be as revolutionary to you, but I challenge you to listen to next time you're talking about the Holy Spirit, or you're praying, or you're doing anything, or teaching about the Holy Spirit, or even just passing through with the Holy Spirit, I challenge you to listen to yourself, and I challenge others around you to listen to you and see which is the more common way you refer to him, because it will change. And it is impersonal. He is extremely personal. So much so, he's not only with you like any other one that would walk alongside of you and with you. He is in you. He is personal. He's not it. Therefore, Star Wars have nothing on him. He is not a force that you can say, may it be with you. Is he. We've already talked quite a bit about the Holy Spirit, and so the Holy Spirit comes by knowing Jesus, because Jesus is personal, Jesus is living, because you know him, he gives you part of himself, he gives you himself, the Spirit of the living God he gives to us. It's not part. If it was part, then it would be it, right? You can give part. This is one, I don't think you've heard me, because there's a lot of stuff. In fact, I think it was Linda or somebody in here a while back said to me, Don Pearson, when are you going to teach on prayer? We need it too. Well, part of it was because when you've been teaching on it for 13 years, you're ready not to teach on it anymore, okay? Now, I do it a lot, but I heard myself, I've just went totally brain dead, right in the middle of it. Bailey Manor's coming closer than I thought. Did it say? It's contagious. No, you don't even know the other one's there. You got it? Oh, man. The issue of him being personal and being with us and speaking to us and walking with us. When it comes to prayer, I'm not asking it for something because it can't give it. Because it has nothing to give. An it can be given, but an it can't give. It's not alive. This is the thought. I knew if I kept rambling like that, sooner or later it'd come back to me. No, they better say it now before it goes away. I've asked this question over and over again. I did it at New Zion. I did it at West End. I did it at West End. One of the first night I preached on God answering me. And I asked the question, if God gives himself to me, do I get all of God? I get all of God. I don't have part of God in me. God gives himself to me. He gives himself to me. I get all of God. Here's a question that I'm not planning on unpacking, and I recognize that some of you will want me to unpack this, and because it's because of tradition and a way that you have been taught to interpret a particular passage, but I'll go ahead and mess your mind up since my mind is messed up. So when I pray, do I have access to all of God? Is there more of God to get if two of us pray? No. If I get access to full God, all of God, when I pray, there's not more of God to get if there's two or three of us praying. Would you agree? That is a faith issue. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man believes, one of the things he believes is that when he prays, he has access to all of God, and that there's not another part of him out there that he doesn't have access to. There's not more of God that I get when there's more of us praying. Or God, if there is, then God isn't it. But if God is a He, and He promises to give Himself to me when I draw nearer to Him, when I call out to Him, when I pray, then I have full access to all of God. There's not more of God to get when there's two more of us praying. But there's more of us that He gets. God will move in the answer to one effectual, praying, righteous man. But he longs for his people to seek him like that one would. Because he desires all of us, and not just all of us, but all of us. The Holy Spirit is a He. It's not an it. There's a lot of it's that come from the Holy Spirit, just like there's a lot of it things that we receive from God the Father and from Jesus, and we could go through that whole list, but the Holy Spirit is a He. Let me give you some passages to think about in relationship to that Him being He. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. What does this He do? Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seductive spirits and doctrines of devils. So what does the Holy Spirit do? As a He, as a living God, as God, what does the Holy Spirit do? He speaks. It don't speak. God speaks. And the Holy Spirit speaks. He spoke in latter times. He moved in men of old in order to inspire them, to teach, speak to them the very scripture that we have before us. He speaks. In John 14, 26, we've looked at this passage before. Because he speaks, he teaches. He teaches. He trains. He directs. He teaches. In John 16, 13, he not only speaks and teaches, he wants to guide. He desires to guide us. He's not a force that guides us. He's not a star in the sky that guides us. He guides. John 16, 7 and 11, he convicts. He comes into our lives, and I think it's interesting that, and I'm not careful, in fact, I probably need to move on because John 7, chapter 16 is where we are next week. And so let's move on, because if I'm not careful, I will preach next Sunday morning sermon from John chapter 16. But he convicts. I love Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians 4. I'm about to divert. After this one, I'm going to divert a slide. We'll come back to the next slide, but I'm going to divert. Ephesians 4, 30. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. Because he is a he feels. He feels. He has. I think I recognize that not all the fruit of the Spirit are deal with emotions, but it's interesting how many of the fruit of the Spirit actually deal with emotions. He feels. He has emotions. Over and over again in the Old Testament, the Father, God, Yahweh, Jehovah, whatever you call him, God, is often described or revealed as being hurt or having emotions, and he can be grieved. That's why I diverted to Acts chapter 7. He can be resisted. We'll come back to the other one, but Acts chapter 7, verse 51. Listen to it. You stiff neck and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always always resist the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, as your fathers did, so do you. I probably should have done this one first. I don't know whether the Holy Spirit... I don't think the Holy Spirit grieves like we do. Okay, let's put it that way. I don't think the Holy Spirit goes into deep depression, mourning, with tears and all of that. But I do think that when we resist him, when we fight against him, when he is convicting us and teaching us and trying to guide us and speaking to us, and we resist all of that and we choose to go and do what is right in our own eyes, when we resist him, we grieve him. And I don't know what that means. I definitely know it doesn't mean he goes into depression. I don't believe that. But I do think he feels sorrow. Let me tell you why. Do you remember one of the things that, well, we haven't gotten to there, but it's in Matthew instead of John, so we're okay. Remember when Jesus gets right to the garden, what Matthew sees in Jesus? It says, and he began. Evidently, before that, he all the other stuff, he wasn't in sorrow, but it says he began to become greatly sorrowful. And as he moves away again, they say, and he states it again, and he was greatly troubled and sorrowful. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of God. I've already done that with you when we talked about the Holy Spirit as part of the Trinity, that in Romans it has no problem. In the same chapter, it'll call him the Spirit of God, the Spirit of the Father, the Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit, on and on and on. It has no problem using those languages interchangeably in the same verses in a very short period of time. We get confused by that, trying to say, okay, which one it is. But yet, the bottom line is he is all of those. He's the Spirit of God. And because of the Father and the Son are God, not gods, but God, the Holy Spirit is God. And just like Jesus was grieved, I do believe that the Holy Spirit can be grieved. And it can't be grieved. Have you grieved the Holy Spirit lately? So when would that be? When God is trying to direct you or teach you, to challenge you in another direction, but you resist that and you do what you want to do anyway, you do what is right in your own eye, you ignore the Holy Spirit, and you go ahead and do what you want to do, you end up grieving the Holy Spirit. What I don't think, I don't deal with quenching the Spirit in here, even though I do believe you can quench the Holy Spirit. That is when you water down, you try to snuff out what the Holy Spirit is wanting to do in your life, and you just kind of just ignore it. You go on quenching the Holy Spirit as he speaks and he teaches in your life. But grieving, there's been all-out rebellion. You have decided that you don't need him. He comes alongside of you as a comforter and a helper. He's there to help you. You grieve him when you reject his help. The other passage that I wanted to take you back to is also in Acts. It's Acts chapter 5. There's whole theologies written off of this one, this whole chapter, Acts chapter 5, early in the chapter. Some of you may not know this story. I recognize that we have some that are still new to the Christian life, and so let me read at least enough of the story for you to get what is going on. It says, "But a certain man named Ananias, and with Sapphira his wife, sold a possession and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, and they brought a certain part, and they laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why hath Satan filled thy heart to what? To lie to the Holy Ghost, and to keep back part of the price of the land. While it remained, was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not in thy own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thy heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God. And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost," not the Holy Ghost, he just died. "And great fear came on all them that heard these things. And the young men arose, wound him up, wrapped him up, and carried him out and buried him. And it was about the space of 3 hours after this, when his wife, not knowing what had happened to him," isn't that history? "They carried him out, buried him, and nobody told the wife yet. 3 hours later, she comes in. Peter answered unto her, tell me whether you sold the land for so much. And she said, yes, for so much. Then Peter said unto her, how is it that you have agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of them which have buried thy husband are at the door, and they shall carry thee out she fell down straightway at his feet, and she yielded up the ghost. And the young men came in, found her dead. Can you, how'd you like to be those young men? I already decided long ago I didn't want to be Ananias and Sapphira, but I don't want to be those young men either. They came in and they found her dead, and they carrying her forth buried her by her husband. And great fear came upon all the church and upon as many as heard these things. Well, I wonder why. I wonder why. I preached on this when we went through the Acts, talking about the church that cannot be hindered, and talked about how the church cannot be hindered from one or even a couple or an army of couples that choose to work against the Spirit of God. They may feel like a hindrance to that pastor and to others who want to do the will of God, but if they abide with the Father, God will take care of those others. He always has and always will. Part here, though, about the he. Twice they lied to God. They lied to the Holy Ghost. It's a he. I have no covenants with my toaster. I have no agreement with my toaster. I don't even use it every day. I did this morning. Had a chocolate Pop-Tart. I mean a fudge chocolate Pop-Tart. Fudge on the outside and fudge on the inside. I can't lie to my toaster. I don't care a thing about it. I'm not going to have a conversation unless it burns my Pop-Tart. And if it burns my Pop-Tart, thy conversation, I realize, is going to be one-sided. It's not, that toaster will not be any better. It will not promise, it will not make a promise to me that it won't ever do it again. Not going to happen. I have no covenant with my toaster. I don't have a covenant with my microwave. I don't use our microwave often, usually to boil water for tea. That's about all I ever get out of it. That's about all I want out of it. I don't have a covenant with my toaster, with my microwave, with my dishwasher, my refrigerator. I don't have a covenant with my TV or anything else in my house that has no life. They are there for me to use, and I use them, I abuse them, and when they break, I get another one to replace it, because I have no covenant, no bond with that thing. In my house, well, used to be only one, but now I have two. In my house, there are only, and I'm not talking about the dog either. In my house, I have a covenant with Trish. I better not treat her like my toaster. I can't treat her like my microwave, my refrigerator, dishwasher, or any of the other things in my house. I have a covenant with her. I have no business lying to her. If I say something or make a promise to my toaster, it's not going to hold me to it. And I won't remember it. But she will hold me to a promise I made, even if it was 40 years ago. The other one in our house is Sydney right now. Our covenant with her right now is, have I told you this? I don't think she'll care. I told her, I said, you won't have any problem from your mama. She don't have much OCD in her. I said, but I'm OCD. And here's my covenant with you. You make a mess, you clean up your mess when you make the mess. I don't want to hear any excuses. When you make the mess, you clean up your mess. When you make the mess. And she said, okay. And I'm going to tell you something. That's one clean girl. Not once. Of course, it helps when she stays at her other mamma's and stuff, but not once have I had to worry about her. I did tell her, your room is your room, and I'm not going in your room. What you do in your room is your room, that's your room. I'm not going to mess with your room. But her bathroom, I told her, I said, your bathroom is your bathroom until we have guests, or until I have an emergency, then it becomes mine. There is something else alive in my house, but that dog, I don't have a covenant with that dog. He thinks I do. He does have a covenant with me. He sure does. He thinks that that bed and all of that bed is his bed. Whether we're in it or not, he thinks it's all his bed. He is a burrowing dog. So he comes and he scratches right at your head because he wants you to lift up the cover because he doesn't want to sleep on top. He wants to be warm. And it don't matter whether it's 90 degrees in that room, he's going to burrow all the way down by your feet and usually come right back here. And he's going to lay there. And you're all night long, you're moving that little dog that doesn't weigh but 5 pounds. Here's the point. You can only lie the Holy Spirit, and it only becomes serious because you're supposed to have a covenant with Him. And you have a covenant with Him because of your relationship with Jesus, and because Jesus, the Father, and the Holy Spirit are God, the Trinity, the Triune God. You have a covenant with the Holy Spirit. And any time you lie to God, don't expect it to go well. Now, it is true over in Psalms, he does make this statement that God does not always treat us the way our sins deserve. And aren't you glad? Yeah, he doesn't always treat us the way our sins deserve. But oh my goodness, it's not the always. It's about the sometimes. Because sometimes he does. And Ananias, Sapphira was holding on to the always and failed to realize that there are sometimes when he does treat you the way your sins deserve. And the truth is, if it wasn't for the grace of Jesus, that would be the reality for all of us. Because all of us would be living in the sometime and not thanking Him for the other times when He chose not to. Not a stomping, spitting. Aren't you glad, Sears, I didn't spit on you tonight? Not a stomping, spitting message. Pretty simple. In fact, I probably could have quit right when I started. One thing I want you to get, Holy Spirit is He. He's alive. He's God. He's real. He feels. When the Holy Spirit is in you, you feel more than you did before. You know why? Because the Holy Spirit is in you. You feel a lot more than you did before. Men and women that never really cared much about what other people thought or about their own actions, all of a sudden when the Holy Spirit comes, will find themselves crying over what they have done where they never would have cried before. They find themselves hurting when they never hurt before. They find themselves feeling conviction where they never felt conviction before. Emotions that they've never had before, they now have. Why? Because He lives in you. I think it's still true what Carrie McNally heard from Ricky. If you don't see much sign of the fruit of the Spirit in your life, it's probably because you don't have the Spirit in your life. One of the amazing things that I have enjoyed the last few weeks is watching and listening to those two over there. And listen to how God is working in their life and what they're feeling and their thinking and the excitement that they get when they look into this Word, and watching their love for one another grow as much as their love for you and for the Lord. Watching others. That should have been the way it was when you first got saved. Do you remember those emotions? Because of He. He is with you, and He is in you. And you're not the same as you were anymore. Because He lives in you. There's something that you've been experiencing, the incredible grace of God in your life lately. You're holding on to the passage that He doesn't always treat you the way your sins deserve, but perhaps tonight He has convicted you. He has shown and trying to teach you that you are grieving Him, resisting Him, perhaps even lying to Him. What's interesting in this passage, when you lie to the Holy Spirit, it is only because you're lying to others. Did you see that? When you're lying to the Holy Spirit, you're already lying to others. Not to yourself. Now, they are lying to themselves in the sense that they thought nothing would happen. But they knew what they were doing. But they chose to lie to others. Father, in the name of Jesus, I would ask, Lord God, that Your Spirit would have free reign in us, that there would be no way we could quench You, grieve You, resist You. We definitely wouldn't lie to You. I thank You, Lord God, that You did not leave us alone. I thank You, Lord God, that You didn't just give us part of Yourself, but You gave us Yourself. Spirit of God lives in me and lives in many of these. May You find us submissive to Your Spirit tonight in whatever way that needs to be done. If it's an act of repentance or just a time to say thank You. If we become cold and stale because we have so quenched Your Spirit in us that You do not have the full and free reign in us like You should. Father, may You fight within us and take back the ground that belongs to You. It's in Jesus' name we pray.